Obama and Black History Month 2015. As the Obama administration winds down, what is its relationship to Black History Month 2015? Of course, the election of an African American was indeed an historic event, and history books will well record this fact. But it was also an attempt by the Democratic Party to lock in a constituency that would fuel its political ascendancy for generations. In symbol, the election of President Barack Obama was a shock to the system. In substance, it was a lot less so. For beside this symbol stood a reality that black life was under siege. In 2014, summer broke with black protests from coast to coast, led by youth, young people who knew in their heart of hearts that the White House could not protect them from a peculiar American practice of police terrorism. When cops could harass, intimidate, beat, choke, kick, stomp, and kill kids, boys, and men with perfect impunity. Symbol, shining and bright, met substance of blood and tears, and one shattered the other. Tens of thousands stormed the streets in over 200 cities to howl at injustice and to demand now, finally, justice. For them, Ferguson became their Selma, and they faced guns and automatic weapons with courage and fury. Symbols are powerful things, yes, but reality is more powerful still. From Imprisoned Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Noah.
Maybe crazy. Was, can I get a switch?
Remember no, about you see that what's top good? Screen. What's, you see when you see screen, yourself
we,
yeah. up there.
We up there now. We on the air. Man, welcome to the Arena Uncensored. I'm your man Yang Nkrumah, coming today with a high power panel, high power council. Continuation of last week when we were dealing with growth and development, going into the things that they're bringing to the community, some of the aspects of growth and development, talking about the Honorable Chairman Hoover, the vision, the dream that he had, and just what the brothers are doing. But before we get into our show, before we get into this discussion, I'd like for our guests to introduce themselves.
I'm Darrell.
Darrell, you look familiar. Were you on the show last week?
No, it's my twin brother.
Okay.
Let the people know.
They like the arena trying to trick us.
They got to like change his way.
Last week he was.
Nah, I ain't got no hair.
Last week he was boat man. Now he brother.
Nah. I'm Big Z.
Okay.
It's an honor to be here. I'm glad y'all have me.
Thank you for being here, brother. Y'all know me. Your man Vincent Cheeks, entertainer, humanist, activist.
Yeah, I'm Lil G. You know what I'm talking about? Get on, Ben Yasharal, your servant. Peace.
Welcome to the Arena Uncensored.
Yeah.
Quick announcement before we get started. Speaking of the Arena Uncensored, as you all know, we are in a transition from the Arena 2013 to the Arena Uncensored, but we're having some technical difficulties on YouTube, so we're still coming up as the Arena 2013, one word. So if you're looking for us, still keep looking for us under the Arena 2013 on YouTube. All you YouTubers out there, we appreciate y'all watching. We appreciate the comments y'all leaving too. So keep it up. Spread the word. But again, we are in transition. YouTube, hit us up at the Arena 2013. We're transitioning to the Arena Uncensored. You can follow us on Twitter at the Arena Uncensored. Brother Yeager,
what's good, brother? Thank you. Mm-hmm. And we say this, and talking about YouTube, man, is the importance of having black media. You know, anytime that we leave our message or we leave our vision or what we're trying to get in the hands of a people who have historically shown that they don't want the truth out there, from our perspective, there's always going to be some trouble. So like Vince said, the Arena 2013, all one word, no spaces, because when you put spaces between it, YouTube is jacking us again. So all one word. Man, let's get to this high-powered show, man. We're back again, and it's an honor to have brothers from Growth and Development. And what we'll do is do a little recap. Tell us a little bit about Growth and Development, about the mission of Growth and Development, and when the whole philosophy and ideology from Growth and Development came in. Because I know last week we were talking about the inception of being gangster disciples to coming into the whole concept of growth and development. So let's do a little recap on that.
Okay, so we are a community-based organization, promote growth and development of the individual as well as the collective whole, which means, you know, we try to make, you know, boys the men the leaders, and we clean up the community. We don't promote no crime or nothing like that. Mm-hmm. We try to make the boys pull their pants up, mm-hmm. you know. Education is, you know, very strong with us. You know, you got to be educated. Okay. At least have an 8th grade education, you know. Mm-hmm. We want you to have a diploma, go to school, be doctors, lawyers, whatever, you know, because street thugs ain't happy.
Okay,
ain't working, you know. So the vision is for us, you know, become like leaders of our society, you know, open our own stores, mm-hmm. you know, get together and fight police brutality, put somebody in Congress, mm-hmm. right. you know, whatever we can do, you know, to better ourselves.
The whole nine. When did growth and development, what year did it go from the whole thing of saying, okay, we need to be growth and development, and we touched a little bit on it last week, but tell us about how that whole concept came about when it hit the Honorable Chairman Larry Hoover, Free Chairman Hoover, the Honorable Chairman Hoover came up with the whole concept, said, okay, we need to leave from this aspect of who we are to becoming a growth and development.
Actually, like the middle 80s.
Okay.
But it didn't really catch on to, like, you know, the late 90s, mm-hmm. and it's still, since Larry Hoover got locked up, you know, the extra indictment, mm-hmm. I mean, it went just wild because there wasn't no structure, no leadership.
Yeah.
So now, like in the last 2 years or whatever, we getting back together, you know. Mm, but actually, a lot of brothers, you know, for the last like 10, 15 years, been growing, like me, myself.
Okay.
But a lot of younger guys, wasn't really no leadership.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of brothers like me, you know, I went on, you know, did the family thing.
Right.
You know, I just stood back. I see a brother, I talked to him, whatever, but I wasn't really active.
Yeah.
I ain't get really active until the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
So, but... It's been like that. Chairman Hoover been set the blueprint, you know,
for
the growth. Yeah.
You wanna jump in, Big G?
Go ahead,
Big G. Yeah, I mean, it all starts. I mean, once you if you're a human being and you taking notice to what's going around you in your neighborhood,
mm-hmm. right?
You know, and you know that you part of the reason that your neighborhood is so messed up right now is. It come a point where it hits you like it's time to make a change, you know.
Okay.
We got to make a change. We got to start doing something more positive. And, you know, Larry Hoover, he had a vision,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying? He gave us the vision, and we try to take it and run with it.
Okay.
But, you know, at the same time, on the other end, you still have some GDs, which is not the same group of GDs. We growth and development. Mm-hmm. You still have some gangster disciples out there who, you know, who we trying to get on the same page, but, you know, is, you know, certain individuals just stuck in certain ways.
I'm glad you mentioned that because that was leading into the question that I was about to ask, which was, you know, we hear the things you guys say you're doing as far as building up the community and being leaders in the community. How difficult is it to, I guess, counterbalance that other side that you're talking about, which is the gangster disciples, who are still more so, you know, the typical gang or selling drugs and still doing violence and stuff like that? How difficult is it to balance that, those differences?
It's difficult, but it's coming through. It's coming along because if I see a gangster disciple, I'm going to, you know, pull them up like, hey, no. I take your stars off, whatever, you know.
Right.
You ain't representing us.
Right.
Ain't no such thing against the type no more, you know.
So it's not happening. You saying it's obsolete. So that's what, because that was going to be my question. If Chairman Hoover saying we're growth and development, how do you hit, what leadership are these so-called gangster disciples? You know what I'm saying? I don't know if I should say so-called. I don't need these Negroes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
They renegades.
They renegades. Okay.
They ain't got no leadership.
No leadership. Okay.
They ain't got no. Well, some of them do. You got a little sex, yeah. You know, but they're not. We the majority now.
Okay.
The majority now. I mean, and then if they come around, you know, if they got to get with us.
Okay.
Or they can't claim. They can't claim.
Or they can't claim. Now, I want to ask the hard question. Wait a minute. Let me ask before I get in. You know me. If Gideon, if you want to add anything or say anything to the.
Well, first of all, I'm honored to be in the midst of you princes. You trying to organize. And I heard you mention about the young men. Of course, we, you know, white supremacy targets our men. But the key thing is it's women primarily that's raising our children. You talked about the man's pants sagging, our son. And I know each generation, I'm probably older than all of you.
Right.
I was about to bust 60 up in here. Exactly. But yet, I don't hear you mention anything about women. First of all, are women allowed in your group? And just like the men's pants are coming down, the women's dresses are coming up. And they walk around in basically what looks like they draws in my generation. What is it that you're focusing on in reference to that, if anything, and how it, are women allowed in your group as well?
Okay, we got sisters. Yeah, sisters of the struggle, you know. And they got to follow God like we do. Like, we can't have our pants sagging, they can't dress around like a prostitute,
right.
You know.
Exactly. Next time, I want y'all to bring a sister.
Like my brother said last week, you know, we don't allow, you know, gay women, but correct. They can aid and assist us.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But they got to go by our codes.
Right.
You know.
So, are y'all discriminating? So, like your brother said last week, y'all don't allow gay women. I mean, y'all allow gay women to support, but don't allow homosexual men to support. If this is a truly, you know, I got to play devil's advocate.
Okay. That's how we do on the
You know how we do. You know how we do. So, I'm not, so is this discriminatory practices? Is this saying, okay, we accept it out of the women to be homosexual, but not out of the men to be homosexual? How do you address that issue? What if the homosexuals say, well, okay, y'all letting homosexual women support the group, but homosexual men can't support the group? How do you answer that, your critics to that?
That's kind of tough.
that's what the arena uncensored is all about, baby.
Well, honestly, I have never came to no situation myself dealing with a gay guy in the organization.
Right.
You know, so I wouldn't say it's discriminatory. I don't even know how everybody feels. You know, I can't speak for everybody,
right.
But, you know, as it being one of our rules and regulations, you know, I mean, I support them. I mean, when we doing stuff in the community, you know what I'm saying, we passing out clothes to the homeless, you
mm-hmm.
know what I'm saying,
mm-hmm.
we not going to not pass this homeless guy nothing because he's gay.
Right.
Because mm-hmm.
mm-hmm.
he's still cold out
mm-hmm.
there.
Right.
You know?
Teach.
I mean, we got to, like I said, I don't discriminate on nobody. I hope the organization don't, you know, because... No,
what you say about that?
Well, what I'm saying is, all right, these laws and policies we go by was made in the 80s.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, back then it was like,
Yeah,
right,
have
right, it.
Right.
And one reason why it Hoover put it out was because it was a lot of guys in jail back in them days raping.
Oh, yeah.
Or having homosexual, you know, relationships
yeah,
in prison.
Yeah, right,
and they
yeah.
were calling themselves gangster disciples.
Mm.
That's
right,
what we're
right,
disciples.
Right, right, right.
So
right, right.
he cut it out.
Okay.
You know, that,
yeah.
That don't represent us.
Right,
no.
Right.
Because
right.
how we look at it, every member represents us.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Well, whatever he do,
light.
Whatever
yeah.
he do,
mm-hmm.
going to reflect on me
right.
and the whole nation.
Right.
So we can't have no man going down on another man,
man
or kissing
right.
another man, and
right.
that don't represent me.
Well, I'm
exactly.
glad you said that, because that sheds a light from the perspective of the GDs and
mm-hmm.
why even Mr. Hoover instituted it. Like
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Right.
yeah, but, you know,
so what about
at the time going,
right,
that's what I'm going to get to.
Right.
At the time
yeah.
going, you know, it might change, because
right.
we're changing with the world. The world's moving. We
yeah.
got to move with it.
Right.
Mm.
Yeah.
So that's how I'm looking at it. I don't know when, or, you know, but maybe we might start letting them serve food to the homeless, or, you know.
Okay.
They
okay.
can aid, well, I mean, I guess they'd be able to aid the sisters one day, but not today.
Right, mm-hmm. not today.
Well,
not today.
And I guess for me, if you're trying to leave the image behind of the gangster disciples, right?
Yes.
And you're moving more into the image of a community-based organization that wants to uplift the community, is there, I guess what I'm trying to say is, you said at some point there may be a possibility,
yeah.
right? So that would mean, like, as an organization, do y'all have a council, or is it one particular guy you go to that enforces all of the rules, or do you say, look, this guy is this way, and he's saying he wants to participate with us in giving out close to the homeless?
We have powers that be, you know, and if so happen the change does come to that effect, it probably would come from the powers
but
that be.
But is it a
group? We got board members, and you know,
so it's a whole bunch.
And that's a good question.
Right.
And that's a good question. Is it a democratic process?
Right. That's what
say you say the majority of the members say, hey, we don't want homosexuals in a group,
right.
And the majority of the members vote
and that
rule.
With that rule,
so it is a democratic process. Yeah. Let me ask you this, because I want: when did y'all leave the black? When I was coming up, I'm an OG. I'm old school. I'm 42 years old. When I was coming up, the colors, you know, the Gangster Disciples, they were the black Gangster Disciples, and they wore black and blue.
What it was started,
when did they? When did they stop being BGD? When they stop being 274?
That's when growth and development started.
So why did we leave the black? Why did you leave the black?
We dropped the B because we got brothers of all different colors.
Right.
That you know, everybody got a job or, you know, they can help us in certain type of ways. Like, without the white people, we would, you know, Martin Luther King wouldn't have did what he
right.
did.
Right. Hold on.
That was the thing on start without no white people. With the white people.
The man
is one of the reasons we're in the condition.
But the point the man is trying to make is that without some good white people that we wouldn't have made the progress that we
did. We had to have,
they ain't in the history books. Okay. But they dead right along with the rest of us for being nigger lovers, you know what I mean? But you had to have that segment of good white people to help further our movement. You know what I mean?
That's true.
Just like Sue Ann helped push our show along.
We help Comcast, brother. Don't ever get it.
You know what I mean? But we help each other. You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. You know what I mean?
And it's more like a power thing, too.
Okay.
Because they got their own sets. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of, you know, Salmon City Roars and, you know, different type of, you know, they gang.
Okay.
And we control that.
Okay.
That's another way we control them and make sure they doing the right thing.
Staying on the track.
Make sure they doing the right thing.
Basically, what we're hitting on is that the movement. See, here's my whole thing. You know, when we're looking at the movement, especially coming out of Chicago. Chicago is one of the birthplaces of what they call gangs, but I call black empowerment movements.
Right.
You got the Honorable before Chairman Hoover, had the Honorable David King David. You got Imam Malik, formerly known as Jeff Boyd, so on and so forth. My man sending shouts out to Chief National, spoken to the Lord, Minister Rico, who is now the old man of the Lords. So my thing is, a lot of these groups started out as black empowerment groups, groups that controlled the black community, kept the different ethnicities, the Italians, the Polish, the Germans, from coming in the neighborhoods and doing what they wanted to do, or that would put up these borders so that black people couldn't expand. And kept us stuck in the slums and so on and so forth. So do you find that multiculturalism, that the inclusion of other groups has taken focus away from the attention on the black community?
No. Because
please enlighten us, brother.
Because just like he said, the thing is, we the ones in power.
Okay.
So if we marching, they marching right with us.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And if need be, they go get their daddy, that's the lawyer, to go up there and help us out any way they can.
But that's my point.
That's
my point. My point is, when you look at the board, when you look at Chairman Hoover, when you look at the leadership that's incarcerated, how many of them are white and how many of them are black?
Well, I don't think they had many white.
Exactly, white privilege. They will be growth and development to them cuffs come on, and they start trying to lump them in with the Negroes, because we on cable, until they lump in the Negro. And this is not knocking, just having a discussion, because one of the things, like I said, that I've always admired about our street tribes, and especially these particular groups, was the going all the way back to the to the Woodline organization, when they started giving them grants and things of this nature to empower black community.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And these same good white folks set up Jeff Fort. These same good white folks used people like Chairman Hoover, used them as scapegoats.
Right.
Yeah. They were robbing these same people that came in and allegedly supposed to help the communities that were getting all these government grants. You got a $10 million grant, they give a brother like Brother Jeff Fort $5,000 and didn't want to charge him for racketeering, and where's the other, $9 million or something?
Yeah.
Is this a concern? But do you find, does this really, has this, how long has the
You said since growth and development, you dropped the black. Do you find that the multiculturalism, the inclusion of the other groups, really work and has been effective in the mission of growth and development? Yes, let's go to Big G.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I mean, us coming together, I mean, we don't really draw off numbers, mm-hmm. but, you know, you got people that's dedicated in all races, all ethnicities. Okay. You know, and long as you're dedicated in your heart there and you're not just reading this, you taking it and you living it, you know, and you really about this, then you my brother. I don't care, you know, what color you is.
Right.
You know
on.
What I'm saying? Long as we on the same page,
right,
you know.
On.
But if you out here gangster discipling with it, then you no longer my brother. I can't call you my brother. I wouldn't even shake up with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're not doing what we doing, if you're not trying to help us out, then I don't have no need for you. I don't need you around me. I don't need the negativity.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of the reasons I moved away from Chicago. Once I had my little boys, I knew it was a wrap. You know, it's time to do something different. I can't let them come up there. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And that's why we here. You know, we try to get into all the guys' heads so you know we can stop Atlanta from coming close to being like Chicago.
Right on.
Mm-hmm. Right on. And the only way we do that, we get in these young people's ears and let them know that, hey, what y'all doing, that ain't the way. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of mothers go lose a lot of kids behind this craziness, and we can all live in peace and everybody function well together.
Right on.
And one thing I know about, see, I grew up around white people.
Okay.
You know.
Me too.
This side of the street, probably white. This side, you know, you couldn't even cross it at a certain age, you know, like in the 70s. But as I get to know certain white people, and they be like, you cool, you know, I was used to be scared of you, but, you know, right. It's like the more white members we get, the more of them getting to know us, and that's cutting down racism. Okay. Because if you know, if you know the enemy, you're probably not the enemy.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. I like that.
Well, what's the like the racial makeup of the GDs? Would it be like 70% black? I'm sure it's majority black, correct? Yeah. Do y'all have any white members?
Oh, yes.
They got a cool one that I'm super cool with. Actually, you know,
okay, Casper.
Yeah,
that's the guy.
Yeah.
But it's still primarily a black organization that works in black communities.
Okay, and that's the thing.
You know, I want to ask this question because one of the primary issues in our community is domestic violence. And if what you're saying is correct and you're trying to help in the community, let's say a situation is developing. So many of our brethren are going to jail on the humbug based on some okey-doke nonsense.
Right.
How would you handle a situation of domestic violence? Because it's one of the most difficult issues for police who are armed and got backup, tasers, guns, you know, all kind of equipment, but the domestic violence scenario is one of the most difficult on the planet. How would the growth and development scenario handle a domestic situation to keep a brother from going to jail?
Real growth and development brothers, you know, we been ain't found out you hit on a woman.
Mm. Right.
We do not hit women.
Right.
You know, you in trouble with us if you hit your woman.
Mm.
You know, right. Come to us, we talk to it, work it out or whatever. But so more members we get, less women's going to get hit.
Okay, I heard that.
That's how I look at it like that. But, you know, if you do, hey, we ain't really got your back because, you know, you're on your own on that one.
So,
know?
Wait a minute. Let me follow up because on the flip side, suppose it's the brother who, because you got the woman out there dressing in her drawers, just about, you know, the mini skirts, stuff that, and, you know, it may be a brother who misinterprets a situation and he comes to you about his woman because she out in the street doing what she do. So how would you, because see, automatically, you think it's the brother. And I understand you say, if the brother hit the woman, but suppose she hit him first. You understand?
That's why we got sisters.
That's why I'm asking.
And we would let them deal with it.
Right, and they got sisters.
And they going, we got some sisters.
Oh, man, we was at
and
that.
And they would deal with it. We let them deal with it. You know,
we
that's
got
the
that
woman,
rally.
You know, since we can't put our hands on them, we let the sisters. But we ain't telling them to put their hands on her. You know,
right,
talk
right.
to her, you know. You know, they like just like us. You know, they got to grow and develop too. They GD too.
Okay. And they got sisters.
So they go by our rules too.
That we was at that rally. And I had the privilege. One of the sisters wanted to speak to me, you know, being the Panthers, representing the Panthers. Mm-hmm. Wanted to speak to me, man. I went up. She was surrounded by other sisters. I thought they were going to frisk me. Right. Them sisters, and I was like, dang. There it is. You know, I mean, them sisters was like tougher than the brothers. I was like, I'm on this side. But I wanted to know. So with saying that, though, when you say that you handle business, it's more than just an organization. You brothers and sisters have a culture. Is it a culture that goes
into
this way of life?
We're family.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. Family.
Yeah.
You know, we
explain
brothers
that family.
I mean, just like real brothers. I treat him just like my real brother. You know, if he needed anything, he get put out or whatever, he can call me.
But when I mean culture, I mean like with a culture, you know, like most religious people are in other communities that have a culture. They have a code of conduct, a way of carrying themselves, a way of, you know, like the Chinese have a Chinese culture. You know, take the shoes off when they sip sake, you know, and I'm not trying to be, you know, profile, I'm trying to be, you know, that type of thing. But so is there a culture that goes along with it? When you become growth and development, is it a complete and total transformation and reformation? Like, talking to, like, yourself, and I want to get both of your opinions, because what I love here is this generational thing we got going on.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? So when you came into it, did it change who you were as Daryl at first? And I pose the same question to you, Bowman.
When I came to it as a gangster disciple, or when I turned to a growth and development?
Well, but let's touch on
both
of those.
So you
were
part of both dynamics.
Yeah, I was back in 1979.
Okay. You were the original.
Well, actually, when I came to it as a gangster disciple, it was more like a family thing, you know. It was a gang, a tribe, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. I mean, we ain't going to let nobody do this or that, you know. It's about respect, though. Yeah. You know, about respect. But it was a gang, so if somebody in our neighborhood and they disrespecting, hey, we all coming, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad I don't live like that no more because I started to love my black brothers. Back then, you know, it was more of the gang, more beaten. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you disrespect, just say you did hit your woman. We come to your house and beat you down. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And, it ain't about all that beating down no more because it's organizations. You know, organizations don't beat each other down unless they really have to.
Unless it's Christians against the Muslims.
Unless they really have to.
You know, we ain't religious based either, you know. So, but when I came to Gangsta Type, it was like a whole new, it's like joining religion.
Okay.
I mean, not Gangsta Type, growth and development. Right. It's like joining religion. You know, it's things you cannot do. It's like, it's certain, you know, days of the week we got to get together, you know, and discuss on what's, you know, just say him, for instance. I asked you, hey, you know, what you've been doing to grow and develop this week, you know what I'm saying, from last week, you know what I'm saying? It's just, you know, to test each other, you know. Just
progress.
To, on progresses, and then, you know, we come together, we have cookouts and get together, do all type of stuff, you know.
Do y'all have any serious internal beef as far as Gangsta Disciple and growth and development? Like,
very
have y'all had
it's very
like
serious.
Serious?
It's very serious.
Conflict.
It's very
it's serious. It's serious because, you know, we live in two different ways.
Right.
They
that's
out there on
saying.
The negativity.
Right.
But they still repping this.
Right.
You know? So, yeah, that becomes a problem. Mm-hmm. So now, while we out here trying to do good, we still got. And we trying to let folks know that we not no gang and we're no longer, we living on another path.
Right.
And then we turn around and this guy go in the store and steal with a 6-point star on, then it's contradicting everything that we got going on.
Right.
Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Hold on, along those same lines, so do you guys have, I guess, any PR people, public relations people? And the reason I say that is because prior to y'all coming on last week, whenever I thought of GD, I just thought Gangsta Disciple. I had never heard of growth and development. So do y'all have like a team of people that is promoting the quote-unquote new brand?
The thing is, we all promote it.
We all promote
it. We all got to, that's why we all got to know our laws.
Right.
You know, and know how to present ourselves.
Right.
Like you asked him, what, you know, explain growth and development.
Growth and development. We're a community-based organization that promotes within the individual as well as collective whole.
I like that. Mm-hmm. I like that. So let me ask this. but I forgot my.
Well, let me jump in here, because when we talk about athleticism and we talk about the former concept of the quote-unquote game, how do you condition the young people? Because from my understanding, and see, I come out of a church-based background. Nothing but games. You talking about games. the Hebrews, the Muslims, the Christians.
The Muslims are not the game.
The apostles, the AME, the Baptists.
They're nothing but games. You can't go from one to the other. They all got signs. But when we talk about trying to understand how to be healthy, how to interact in relationships, what do you teach your young men and women about being men and women? I know what you said about the philosophy, but I'm talking about specifics, because, you know, tribalism in Africa, what they would do is take a young man at a certain age and they would take him through certain rituals. Do you all have rituals for your young men and women to prove, like you asked him a certain question about growth and development, to prove their manhood? Do they give them tests? Do they have to eat certain foods? Or is it just do what you want?
No, it ain't do what you want, but we don't. I mean, you know, we promote healthiness. You know, eat right, take care of yourself. You know what I'm saying? But it's more like it's a knowledge thing.
Okay.
And we more like you gotta prove us to yourself. You know, you be like, you know, like probation period or something like that. Okay. Yes. You know, so we really, you know, before you can join us, just say you're a gangster disciple and you want to really turn GD. You put on hold until you can prove to us, you know, you right. And we give you the guidelines to follow.
Okay.
We give you the guidelines to follow.
Yeah.
So you know, you can't just say, I'm not doing gangster disciple no more. Now I'm growth and development.
We gotta be able to accept you. Okay. The whole gotta accept you.
Okay. Let me ask this, and I love these questions they ask. I guess, you know, me coming up in the street tribe, already being, you know what I'm saying, what they would call gangs and stuff. A lot of the questions you ask, I'm like, for real? Y'all don't know this?
Bruh, but I was raised in a very strict, don't look at gang. We ain't have a lot for a lot of stuff, but it, don't look at gang, don't talk to gang, don't. My mama was
that comes. See, that'll come from living around in white folks.
We
lived in the hood. If you was going to click up trying to get to the movie theater, you learned about it. You know what I'm saying? When you just had to go to the corner, you had to be with somebody.
Yeah.
You know? Yo, I got to go to the store for my mama. Me too. Let's all click up. And in fact, we're going to call ourselves the 34th Street Brothers. Yeah. You know?
Right. I mean, but I guess that explains my naivety too.
Yeah.
To when, you know, that you said GD, and my first thought was, well, gangster disciples.
Well, one of the things you find happening now, and I'm going to go back to my question, is now, and this is part of my question, is now, like I said, moving to Atlanta, you know, and all the people out there that know Yanga know no things, you know, I'm an OG Crip. Mm-hmm. One of the things that you find now is more cliques. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? People have a choice of who they want to be with. When I was coming up, I lived in a Crip neighborhood. It wasn't even an option. You didn't get to say, okay, I'm going to live in a Crip neighborhood, but I want to be Boo Boo Boys.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? If you didn't live in Boo Boo Boy hood, it wasn't no option.
Yeah.
But one of the things, do you find as far as coming out here with this age of information, the internet age, you know, when I go out and talk to the young brothers and say, hey, man, you know, Crip was a revolutionary group, community revolution in progress, community revolution, independent party, you know, representing that, and they pulling out, well, you know, the pyramid has three entrances and four gates, and under the golden brick road is a rose and all that. Do you find
it
more?
We don't live under the pyramid.
Right. Do you find
it? You know, but I'm
keeping it 21.
Yeah.
We're living in the day of the internet.
Yeah. Right.
Where these dudes who want to be down with something, they Googling it up.
Right.
They're getting all of this misinformation, disinformation. Do you find it harder? Because I've talked to young men, they tell them, you know, I'm 42. I've been there since I was 10. You know, that's 32 years. I'm an OG, double OG. You know, so this and that. And they looking at me like I'm lying. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm making something up. Do you find it hard to pull them into the concept of growth and development with the misinformation, disinformation that's going on these days?
When a brother give me some information and I know it's some crap, you know, I try to take time to teach them. You know, I try to let them know, hey, brother, you know what I'm saying? It don't make sense for you to be out here representing it and you're not really about it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Let me show you how to get on the right path and, you know, you can be real and can't nobody tell you you're not what you are.
Yeah,
you
right.
But what you
how was that received? Do they accept that from you?
I mean, most of the time. Most of the time, because a lot of people just truly be lost. Like you said, the internet and they lost. But, you know, when you come to them and they know somebody that know the real and know what they talking about, you know, they notice it offhand. Like, this brother know what he talking about. He real, you know.
Right.
So, And we give them the option, you know, like we was just talking about, you go through a screening process, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and it takes time. It takes time. It ain't no just you in it. You got to put in work, you know okay. what I'm saying? And our work involves these community cleanups and feeding the homeless, and you got to do a lot of that, you know what I'm saying? You got to show dedication, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Volunteer work is crucial. You know, my youngest son joined the gang. Called the Marine Corps, another gang, the Air Force. These gangs, the Army, these are gangs. What about the people who come out of those gangs? Do you find that you have recruits that come out of the various military gangs coming into your gang? And are any of you past military involved?
I know quite a few guys, you know. I don't live, well, I'm from Chicago, born and raised. I don't live in Indiana, Texas, Arkansas, you know. And I meet a lot of brothers, you know, from military status. You know, we got computer programmers, we got lawyers, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. we got folks out
another
here.
Gang.
Yeah, lawyers, doctors, you know,
y'all fraternity. It's like
that's what I was thinking. It's like
a fraternity. Yeah, you know, when you grow up, it's like I said, I'm 42. I'm hosting a show now. You know what I'm saying? And co-hosting with some wonderful people. So when you grow, I'm sure you're gonna have your affiliations, but you go on to other careers.
I mean, you'll be surprised. You'll be surprised how many brothers, you know, just need a little help. You know, need to know how to get in touch with the GED class. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean. Yeah. It take a lot for a person. I mean, it means a lot for a person to make that first move themselves. But mm-hmm. sometimes people do need a little push.
Call out our number, man, just in case we got some callers out there. This is a live show, so if you want to call in.
Yo, you're watching mm-hmm. the Arena Uncensored. If you want to call in, talk to Growth and Development, get in on the conversation. The phone number is 770-559-2999. Hit us up.
And y'all know y'all want to call in because this may be the closest y'all ever come to Street Tribe.
To some Street Tribe, you know what I'm saying?
You know, y'all be crossing the street, running across the street.
Stop being scared of your own people.
Of your own people.
Yeah.
I got a really good question, and this is very personal and important to me. And it's about financial planning. Do y'all talk to any of the young guys and try to get them involved in things to help them financially plan for the future, like investing and stuff like that, trying to take their street business skills and turn it into legitimate business mm-hmm. skills? Because I tell you like this, every time I saw one of the American Gangsters on BET about, you know, the big gangster dudes. Mm-hmm.
Right. History Channel.
The only thing I can think is these dudes have brilliant business minds. Mm-hmm. They're just using it in the quote-unquote wrong capacity. You know what I mean? So do y'all have any type of program for y'all help?
We push them to, you know, education, you know. Right. That's one of our biggest things, you know.
I love it.
You got an education and you know, where we want to be, you know, we're going to back you. You know what I'm saying? If we have to help pay for your college or whatever, you know, we're going to back you.
That was my next question, because as a former teacher, I taught in Bankhead. And, you know, I saw from an early age that kids were getting miseducated, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Right. And a lot of time it was by us doing this. Yeah. But it's part of us being part of that system, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, that is designed to keep us dumbed down and miseducated and misinformed.
There's hope for you yet. There's hope for this yet.
So for me to hear as a former teacher that you guys are really big on education, you know, I'm all about that. And what I've done as far as just financial stuff, because Black asked me today about my financial situation, do I have good credit? And my answer is, hell's no. You know what I mean? Like, you type in my social in the computer, it might blow up. You know what I mean? That's how bad it is, but that's because I wasn't taught from an early age. So what I've done now, last week I joined an organization called Operation Hope. Mm-hmm. And what they're going to do is teach me financial business, financial language, and then I'm going to go into inner city schools and teach it to, you know, the youth of, you know, communities.
I'll go with you.
So if y'all, you know, if y'all do have a program or want to implement a program like that, I would be, you know, once I get trained and learning and stuff like that, I would love to
Man, call the Panthers too. I know how to behave around them white folk. Yeah, I ain't gonna show out.
I'm trying to find anything I can so I can pass it on to the brothers.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. Yeah. Let me ask. And one of the things when you're talking about fraternity, you know, coming from Cleveland, I really see the fraternity because we had a lot of police officers, and I hope this doesn't make you look bad. We had a few police officers that was actually, you know, growth and development. They would come when they pulled, and it wasn't always slamming brothers to the top. They actually were trying to drop on those brothers.
Right.
So you had that fraternity thing. But what I wanted to ask you, Daryl, do you see a big difference in you being a double OG, triple OG, big homie OG, double OG? You know what I'm saying? Do you see a big difference in from the time that you were coming up and the leaders that you were influenced by and the people you were around, as opposed to the younger brothers coming up and their concept and their understanding and enacting the ways of growth and development?
Oh, man, it's a way.
And what are some of those differences?
It's a way. See, back when I was, you know, gangster disciple, everyone wanted to be bad. Who's the baddest?
Right,
you know what I'm
saying?
Who got the most guns? Yeah. And, you know, it was more about being tough, and it was always a competition, you know. I said, city, you know, killed more people than your side, you know.
Yeah.
They see who could beat, you know. Right. It wasn't about community cleanup. We didn't give a damn about cleaning up.
Right.
And then another difference is from back then, the leaders, you know, we didn't see them.
Nope.
But now, you know, they out here, they in the front, you know what I'm saying?
Right with us.
They right there with us, cleaning up. They on the streets.
Yo, mommy, ask how old are you, Big G?
I'm 39.
Okay, so you're old head. I'm
You're about 25 years old.
I was actually born on the same street Larry Hoover stayed on.
Okay, okay.
So him and my mama, you know, they ran together.
So this is a lot of times. Is this generational? You know what I'm saying? Like I said, I grew up on the block with a certain thing. So, you know, my, you know, uncles, all my relatives was a certain.
It's like you said, it was basically what your hood was, you know, most of the time, because that's all you seen.
Yeah.
And when you go out the hood, it's dangerous.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Once you go out your neighborhood, it's dangerous. Yeah. I had a job at Jewel Food Store. I remember I'm sitting there, I'm riding the bus, I don't dozed off. We get to a certain neighborhood. We had a stoplight. Somebody bang on my window. My head leaning up against the window now. Somebody bang on my window. You know what I'm saying? Mm. I look out. It's like 20 people. They trying to snatch the bus door open and everything. Bus driver, you know, he had to smash out. But you know what I'm saying? I'm like, thank you, sir. And still went on to work like ain't nothing happened. You know what I mean? But.
It feel good not to have to carry a gun everywhere I go.
I know that.
When I was young, I didn't care if I was going to church,
right,
to the police station, get my car upon. I had my gun on me.
How was it being a twin, man? Because I can just imagine if your brother went out there someday.
Well, he told
you. Know
his brother was the one that said to mention it because they kind of went for bad. He carried a gun everywhere.
It was good because nobody wanted to mess with two people.
You
know what I'm saying? We was always in shape.
Yeah.
You know, I took state wrestling.
Yeah.
Right.
So he took third. Only reason he took third because he hit the guy because the guy bit him.
Yeah.
Right.
But we were known as, you know, we were like little celebrities, and you know, so people knew not to mess with us because we can wrestle.
Yeah, because that's why Bowman said you introduced him to the whole thing.
Oh,
he came back.
Yeah, I went to Audi home for attempted theft. They gave me 30 days for attempted theft.
Right.
I was thinking about stealing something.
So you got 30 days.
Well, I did.
Thinking about it. Y'all know thinking about
they
it.
They gave me 30 days.
let me ask you.
In the Audi home.
Because both of you all have beautiful personalities.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I can't even connect you with no gang. You know, you don't even project that. I'm sure you know there's another side to you. But, you know, a couple of things I want to mention. Now, you've been talking about education. And, of course, that's a catchphrase in this modern society. And we know we have what's called, in my generation, some educated fools. Because we got children out here now. Before, when grandmama and granddaddy didn't go to the third grade, they owned businesses. They had most savings. But these people now, quote, unquote, educated, can't save nothing, don't know nothing, ain't bought nothing. So I want to get this understanding about education. And then, secondly, we've seen the number of our children being killed by police, from Eric Gardner to Michael Brown to Brother Jackson down here in Valdosta.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Kenneth Ward.
Corey. Goes on.
So what are you, Tamir Rice, what are you educating? How are you educating young men about dealing
with the police, and of course this issue of education.
Well, basically, you know, it's a respect thing, you know.
True that. True that.
Just, you know, because we gotta follow laws. You know what I'm saying? Law and policy of the state, right, of the nation. So long as we follow law and policy of the nation, we should be okay. But if it do happen,
Michael Brown, hands
almost, I respect Brother Durham. I'm not gonna gamble all that. You follow the laws and policies, boy. Because my whole thing is, and this is why I like to, you know, and shouts out to Big A, man. Shouts out to Iz and everybody, man, that's doing their thing and definitely hooking up with the Black Panther Party, working with us, bringing the guests on, introducing me to Boatman and Durrell, now the Big G, which I hope that we work close together in the future, me representing the Black Panther Party, chairman in Atlanta. But one of the things that does the growth and development look at to being a real force in the political arena? Is that something that the brotherhood and the sisterhood really start to look at?
Yeah, that's one of the things we're striving for. Most definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why we trying to, you know, get everybody together. And, you know, whenever it, you know, we need to do more rallies.
Okay.
You know, more, you know, networking and, you know, fellowshipping with the other, you know, people in the community. Mm-hmm. You know, we try to let it, you know, our first goal is to break the negativity. Mm-hmm. You know, once we break the negativity, of people perceiving us as a gang, and we can get more followers.
Okay.
You know. Well, right. Not only just, you know, they don't have to be growth and development, but long as, you know, we got, you know, numbers.
And I've seen, I saw that at the Unity Rally, man, which is, like I said, and I'm always touching on that because that was one of the most beautiful things that I saw, man. I saw Stones, Crips, Bloods, growth and development.
January 31st.
And like Big A said, you know, back in the day, you had something like that, they'd have been tearing the park up. You know what I'm saying? But the brothers was communicating, even the brothers even went and ate together.
Right.
That's the thing, they was feeding the brothers, so you can see the whole mindset start to change with the different street tribes and the OGs, and I commend, you know, as a Crip, I say OGs, I don't know what other groups call their elder council, and I commend you brothers coming out not having the superior attitude, sit back and, you know, pay homage type thing, and getting out here and really teaching the young brothers what the inception, what it was founded on, and that this is the whole unity thing from that. So I really give big props and kudos to that.
Yeah, I want to say something.
Go ahead, Bob.
I mean, if we can get just half of what a football game can get, you know what I'm saying? Why so people so stuck on the distraction that the white man throw out there? Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right.
Football, baseball, basketball. Right. You know, you can get tens of thousands of people to come to that, but you only can get 200-300 to come to something that's affecting us every day.
Yeah,
these police are killing us.
Yeah.
Hello.
Well, they're killing poor people.
But they'd rather go to a football game or a Jay-Z concert, spend all their money.
Right.
You know.
But the problem, like along the lines of what you're saying, the problem with, and I've seen this amongst people that I know, educated black people, or they get a little money in their pocket and they either forget where they come from or they never even, I didn't even know it was black people that didn't know what the hood was or had never been to the hood. Like that blew my mind the first time I met a person like that.
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Right. Yeah. Even some of the teachers when I taught in Bankhead, they view the kids as some type of subsection of society that, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to go over there, because I used to go over there all the time, walking my kids home. I would never go over there with them people by myself. So there's this separatist mentality that we have to get over. Me, you know, I went to school, one college, so I could, one, better myself, but also so I could go back at some point and help the younger generation achieve the things that I did.
That they're trying to. You know what I mean? Well, see, that's my problem to go in, and I'm going to be brief. My problem with multiculturalism. Mm-hmm. No, just, that's why I say I had a big problem for the, you know, Black Gangster Disciple and pro-black organizations. My problem with multiculturalism is exactly what you just said. Mm-hmm. When we integrated, when we assimilated, it wasn't just so that they would treat us equal. We lost our morals and our ethics.
Right.
We lost what it meant to be black.
Right.
We lost the very thing that we held, you know, that defied black manhood.
Right.
So now when we start taking on their ways, black manhood was defied by your material possessions.
Exactly.
If you ain't got this Benz, brother, if you ain't living in a $100,000 house.
Right.
So when you do that, a lot of times multiculturalism is dangerous for people who don't know who they are.
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? Because when you don't know who you are, you have a tendency to look at other people and say, hey, I like who you are. Yeah. So maybe I'm better being you.
And to that point, I said on Gideon.
You got Negroes early, got Chinese writing on their neck. Duck soup menu on his neck.
I told Brother Gideon on his show earlier, I said the reason that there's so much chaos and confusion in the black community is because our culture was stripped away.
Exactly.
From us,
right.
And we don't know who we are. So
right.
We've had this conversation before.
Yeah.
To that point,
right.
We totally agree. Yeah. And I definitely believe in building, reuniting, and reconnecting the black community as a whole.
Right.
We definitely need that as a collective, like y'all say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We need that. But then once we come together as a collective and each one teach one,
yeah.
Bring each other up,
mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? You don't have to exclude another whole section of people, some of which do understand your plight,
mm-hmm.
And do have your best interest in mind and do want to help, and whether it's black, Spanish, Asian, or what have mm-hmm. you, but when you turn away that section of people, mm-hmm. to me, you're doing what they say, blocking your blessing.
Blocking your blessing. But here, let me say this, and I want to go to them because I want to address that. You know, one of the things is you can do that once you know who you are. It's like you said,
right.
Building.
Right.
You have to, when you're building with other cultures and other, now I like what growth and development is doing. Like you said, they have their whole sections. They have their own, what they would call sets or something. They're working within their communities.
Right.
And we're working within their communities. They work with the brothers in this community. Then we can build because we got the same building blocks.
Mm-hmm.
And that building block is a growth and development building block.
Mm-hmm.
But us as an African people, when you don't have a building block to bring to the table, then they're going to give you their building block.
Yeah.
When they're dealing with us, it's not so much that they identify with our plight. It's no. In some way that is advantageous to them. It helps them.
Yeah.
Point in case, and I'm going to end it with this. You don't believe me? Look at multiculturalism. Yeah. The little rappers, Amigos.
Yeah. Right.
Who the hell why brothers want to be Amigos
exactly.
Now? When I was coming up, these niggas Mexicans now. When I was coming up,
free.
We was Italians. I'm Gambino.
Right.
I'm Gambino.
Yeah.
We ain't enough brothers. You know, it's Scarface.
Yeah.
I'm Scarface. I'm Guinelli
yeah,
Cuban. We never wanted brothers after the 80s
yes.
When we was African Bambaataa,
right.
Public Enemy.
Yeah.
We went from that
X-Clan,
yeah. Rakim, yeah. Agbi, and Rakim. We went from that to being Scarface, Bambito, Gambino.
Right.
Then we the Migos. I go right. To Kirkwood. These Negroes calling it Little Mexico.
Right.
So I be like, I'm going to the woods. Kirkwood, man, that's Little Mexico. It ain't no damn Little Mexico.
Right.
You know, so this is what multiculturalism does. We despise ourselves,
right.
So then what we end
right.
Up doing is worshiping, idolizing, and hero worshiping our people who practice. And the only reason we do that is because they practice unity.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But I've never had that problem, and I've been dealing with multiculturalism my whole life.
That's why you never had that problem.
Let's ask them, though. You know, let's ask with the real growth and development, brother. What do you see about
multiculturalism?
But they're all for it. Y'all ain't been listening.
But I mean, what I just said about that, though. How do you feel about the, you know, brothers taking on other ethnicities, other identities?
I don't like it. I don't like it. You know, you got to learn to love yourself.
Right.
You got to
right.
Be able to look in the mirror and be happy with what you see.
Right
you
on.
Know?
That's yeah, how I love. Me, myself, personally, I'm in the music thing, and I wouldn't call myself, you know what I'm saying?
You wouldn't call yourself a little Eskimo? Little Chinaman?
Eskimo
Jeez. Listen, we're coming down in our last minutes.
We got
and what I'd like to do, you know, is allow everyone to have we got about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, to allow everyone, because I know I get long winded, so in
yeah.
The last, I'm going to want my last 3 points. So let's start with Durham. What's some, you know, some closing thoughts, some things on your mind, some things you like to share or to push and promote? Because
right.
Like Vince was saying, you know, you don't have, what are you doing? What is your PR? What is your public relations? This is your, and man, you always welcome to the arena.
Always
welcome. You always, growth and development is always welcome.
First of all, I can contact you.
Yeah,
please. There you go.
Okay, what y'all doing?
What you about, what you doing, the next events coming up,
yeah.
How you can contact you with you and anything you want to share. Shout outs, you know, black folk, we love to say shout outs.
Shout out to all my kids, all 7 of them.
Okay.
True father, I like that.
Well, I wanted to say, what's been on my mind for like the last 2 weeks is don't believe what you see.
Mm.
You know, right. The news, the media are so, man. They just lying, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I watched a documentary about the Sandy Hook thing, and it messed me up, man. I thought them kids died, man. I felt bad for them kids, man. Mm-hmm. But not one kid died. Not one. Y'all don't believe that.
Yeah.
And they so, they think we so dumb, they show two different schools.
I was that dumb. That's two different schools.
I'm like, what? Then they had people going in and out of the building like it was a whole bunch of people, but it was the same people. It's like, I mean, so right there, it messed me up with the media. It's like, how about most stuff? I already knew about 9/11 was, you know, they did that.
Right.
But everybody know that.
Watch out now.
But the Sandy Hook thing, I believed it until a few weeks ago. And now it's like, if I see somebody talk about, okay, this black woman killed her kids, I'm like, okay, black people don't do that.
Right.
You know, so somebody killed them and they playing it off. She was in the military. Okay, she in the military. They got people in the military anyway.
No doubt.
And you know what I'm saying?
You know what?
Then they're going to leave her with kids?
Kids. That's and I'm going to tell you, and that's a whole nother show we're going to have to have. Right. Because really, first of all, she was diagnosed with severe suicidal tendencies.
Right.
Really? Then they had a history. Her mother said that, even the girl's mother said, hey, she had been institutionalized in a mental institution.
And right. they still didn't give
so there again, a failure of the state. Right. Failure of the state. Damn state.
It's hard to believe, you know. If I don't actually, you know, just like for instance, y'all know that Plumtree Clearinghouse thing?
Yeah.
$5,000 for the rest of your life?
Yeah. Right.
They've been doing that forever. But do you know anybody that know anybody that know anybody?
I ain't never seen one in the neighborhood.
That won it?
Not a one.
I been and shot them. They come to my neighborhood. Where my money at? I don't even know nobody that know nobody that know nobody
that know that.
Yeah.
I just want to say we got to come together. I mean, it's going to take more than the GDs, the Panthers, the Stones, the Crips. You know, it's going to take everybody. You know, the whole Atlanta, the whole Georgia, the whole Chicago, the whole New York, everybody. It's time to change it. You know, we got to do something. We got to come together, you know, and save our community. We got to.
Okay. When Mr. Hoover went from Gangster Disciple to Growth and Development, he created a nonprofit organization to register voters. He had a music label that helped needy children. Mm-hmm. And he also had a clothing line that was for children.
See, they didn't put that on American Gangster.
Called Ghetto Prisoner Wear.
See,
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, they didn't put that on BET.
I thought that was Century Vote.
Yeah, I thought that was just amazing to me because it's all about perceptions. You have this perception of GDs, you know what I mean? And in the past 2 weeks, you guys have really opened my eyes and my mind to a lot of things that y'all got going on. So my question and all that is, what kind of, do y'all have any things like this going on now, like the music label, you know what I mean, to work with? Talk about some of the stuff, because I'm into music too, you know what I mean? And if I can help with that too, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we got LTG Studios, we got SMG, we got...
What does that stand for? LTG and SMG.
Loyal to the Game.
Okay.
What's getting on label?
I'm OG, bro.
Right.
But just tell them how they can contact you.
You contact me personally at 678-913-7827.
And I'm 404-587-5385.
All right, now, y'all know we be getting like 40,000, 50,000 YouTube hits, so when your phone be blowing up, you're like,
right, you want to make sure they get that number.
Yeah. Hey, if you heard what I'm talking about and you want to be, and you feel like you're on the same page and you want to become a part of that, feel free to call.
Right
now,
on.
Now, I feel like I need to ask this just for our viewers out there.
Sure.
Because we're our hood, dude.
Yeah.
We know
straight
about,
up.
We know about the jungle.
Country
we know how to grow up and interact in the jungle. But for those who grew up outside of the jungle and they have a certain anxiety or fear about coming to help because they think it might turn into whatever.
Gang war.
Nah, you safer with us than the people that ain't in the organization.
Right on.
Because we disciplined, you know.
Okay.
We about respect, you know.
And that's what
you
I want
get in
to
trouble.
You
disrespect somebody. If I see him disrespect you, he in trouble.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? And he see me, I'm in trouble.
Right.
Ain't no big ass little to use. You know, he got this much power I got.
Okay. Go ahead, big.
What I was going to say.
It's all right. But, Dad was talking about the safety for the people who want to help.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Stuff
what
like
I was
going to
say.
Make sure they.
You know, we be a little scared too. We much scared of y'all as y'all is. You know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
I mean,
right.
I ain't saying it to be funny, but
right.
y'all see what's going out on the street. You know, the misperception of us can anything can happen.
Right.
You know
yeah,
what I'm saying?
Right. Okay, yeah. I feel
because
exactly.
you
feel.
Might think we're against the disciple. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And want to kick it off. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Exactly.
And
right.
won't even give me a chance
to
even
explain.
You know?
Right.
So you know. Like I said, we're scared. You got the police out here doing what they doing,
exactly.
you know.
Yeah.
So
we got
you know, we just
two
scared.
2 minutes.
Okay. To that end, man, we got to stop being afraid of each other. You know what
yes.
I mean?
We
are not the enemy.
Yes.
Nope. They're the
yeah.
common enemy that was put together to take us apart,
mm-hmm.
and we need to focus on that.
Brother, I just want to say briefly, we've had so many instances where men, just last week, where a brother went in and stabbed his wife. 17 times just trying to get his son. We had another brother kill the whole family,
mm-hmm.
the boyfriend and everything. I just want to say it's brothers like you that have an outlet for people. If there are brothers out there that are stressed out, call Growth and Development.
Call
because we brothers need to speak one to another.
Right.
We need to have confidence.
We need to connect.
We need to be able
connect.
To have somebody that'll listen. So I want to thank you, brothers. The Most High bless you. In the name of Yah and his anointed son, Yeshua. I know you don't believe it. I'm just saying, blessings be unto both of you and your family.
Protection.
I know black,
I
did it like that.
I got it.
Let's
go on the rap. We're going to have a rap, man. This is your man, Yang and Kuma, the Arena Center, coming with this high power council. I guess, Durham, Big G, our usual host, Brother Vince, Brother Gideon. Check us out on YouTube, the Arena, all one word. Yo, we're going to come back when our show be about the crazy atheists.
Keep
doing
it, man.
We talk about the crazy atheists that's killing people. But now, check us out, the Arena. Love having guests. Thank you, brothers, being out there.
Thank you for tuning in out there. All
right. We out here. Peace.
The Arena.
It's a game time, baby.
One love.
Growth and development.
You already
know.
I was nervous at first, but I was nervous.
Y'all did y'all thing.
We gotta break it down.
Okay.
Break it down.